Hello friends, and welcome to the launch of Kinetic Group Chairman Mr. Arun Firodia's book, My Life's Blessings. I'm Abhay Vaidya, Director, Pune International Center. Three stalwarts of the green energy movement in India are with us today. Just last week, the national media reported the unveiling of the indigenously developed hydrogen fuel cell technology in Pune. Mr. Ravi Pandit, Chairman, and Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar, board member, Sentiment Labs, had presented a passenger bus powered by hydrogen fuel cell technology developed in collaboration with CSIR National Chemical Laboratory. Both Mr. Pandit and Dr. Mashelkar are with us today. And the third stalwart in the green energy is none other than Mr. Arun Firodia. A pioneer of two-wheeler mobility in India, Mr. Firodia is now developing an advanced range of electric vehicles and battery swapping stations. His motto is to bring green mobility to the masses, and his firm Kinetic Green has already taken the lead in the electric three-wheeler segment. My Life's Blessings is the very inspiring autobiography of Mr. Firodia, and we will hear more about the book from the author himself. I cannot resist mentioning that in the foreword to this book, Dr. Mashelkar has described Mr. Firodia as the epitome of innovation, compassion, and passion. And he has drawn our attention to two inspiring chapters at the end of this book, India of My Dreams in the New World, and What Can India Offer to the World? Let me now formally introduce our speakers today. Known as Mr. R&D, Mr. Arun Firodia created the famous Kinetic Luna, which gave mobility to the common man, and Kinetic Honda, which brought a new sense of freedom for women in India. The popular catchline, Chal Meri Luna, has remained etched in our mind. Mr. Firodia earned his B.Tech with distinction in electrical engineering from IIT Mumbai. He then did his M.S. in electrical engineering from Massachusetts Institute of Technology and M.S. in management from the prestigious Sloan School of Management, MIT. He was instrumental in designing a 90-seater aircraft as advisor to the government of India. He also developed an earthquake warning system and an audiobook reader for the visually challenged as director of the CSIO, or the Central Scientific Instruments Organization. Honored with the Padma Shri in 2012, Mr. Firodia is a philanthropist and social activist. In 1996, he established the H.K. Firodia Memorial Foundation in the memory of his illustrious father, late Sri H.K. Firodia. This foundation instituted the H.K. Firodia Awards for Excellence in Science and Technology to honor outstanding Indian scientists for their original and world-class contributions to any branch of science. The list of recipients is indeed legendary. The Firodia family has also instituted the Firodia Karandak or CUP to encourage performing arts through inter-college competitions. Mr. Firodia is the recipient of numerous national and international awards and honors. His books include Innovation on Two Wheels, Green Growth, and Smart Cities, which details a blueprint of zero pollution sustainable industrial township. Chairing today's event is Mr. Ravi Pandit, co-founder and chairman of KPIT Technologies and chairman of K&P Group, founder trustee of the NGO Janavani, and director of WRI India and Aga Khan Rural Support Program. He is a fellow member of the Instituted Chartered Accountants of India, and his areas of interest include technologies for green mobility and energy, promotion of knowledge, research and innovation, corporate social responsibility, corporate governance, environment, ecology, and social welfare. Presiding over today's event is Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar, National Research Professor, former Director General CSIR, and President Pune International Center. For those who are new to this think tank, I would like to mention that all our three guests are among the founders and trustees of Pune International Center, which works in the area of national security, energy, environment and climate change, social innovation, Science, Technology, Innovation and Growth, and Economic Reforms and Urbanization. For more information, you may visit our website, puneinternationalcenter.org. This program has a Q&A session, so you may please post your questions in the question box. And may I now request Dr. Mashelkar to present his opening remarks.
Thank you, Abhay. Our most beloved Vice President, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, my very dear friend, Arun Firodia, yet another dear friend, Ravi Pandit, beloved members of the Firodia family, I'm quite sure they're all in attendance in full measure, members of Pune International Center, ladies and gentlemen. Let me extend a very warm welcome to you all. And at the same time, my very best wishes for the new year. The sun will rise in 8 days' time on the new year, and I hope 2022 will be very different from 21 and 20 and 19. And year where we all hope that the war of virus versus vaccine would be won by the vaccine and will be back to the old norms, that of warm handshakes and affectionate hugs. So all our best wishes. To all of us, this is a very special morning because a very special book written by a very special person is being released today, My Life's Blessings by Arun Firodia. I must say that I've had the privilege of reading the book from the first line to the last line, because Arun gave me the honor of writing the preface of the book. I can straight away say it's a great book, it's an engaging book, it's a motivating book, it's an inspiring book, and it's an uplifting book. In fact, I have used the word unputdownable. I mean, I remember finishing it practically end to end. And the book is exceptional because it is a story of the life and work of the most exceptional human being that I have had the privilege of meeting. I have said already. In fact, you know, Arun in the book says that Rahul Bajaj had called his father H.K. Firodia as God's own man. And then Arun used to call Jayashritai, Jaya as he calls her, his wife, as God's favorite creation. But I would go forward and say Arun himself is a God's special gift to our society. And we thank God for giving us that particular gift. A few personal words about Arun. First is, of course, as I said, finest human being, incredible ability with incredible humility, and as was mentioned earlier, innovation, compassion, and passion. You know, I myself am an engineer, and I admire him as a great engineer. I mean, he was introduced as an electrical engineer, but he's beyond electrical engineering. I call Arun a complete engineer. I remember there is this Queen Elizabeth Prize of Engineering, you know, £1 million, almost 8 crores, which is considered as a Nobel Prize in engineering. And it goes to some breakthrough technologies, like, you know, last year it went to light emitting diodes, earlier to GPS, then internet, Web of Things, and World Wide Web, and so on and so forth. So I remember 4 years ago when I got on the jury, they asked me, what is the future of engineering? And I said, there is nothing like chemical engineering, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering. There's only solution engineering. Given a problem, how do you find a solution? So Arun is not just an electrical engineer, he's a solution engineer. And that you see in everything that he does. Never a part of a problem, always a part of a solution. You know, this book, Green Growth, was something that was written by him with an aspiration, guide to a model green city. That was his dream about Pune. And if you read each page, he has stated, of course, the problems, he has stated ideas, but then he has provided solutions with actual numbers. So he's a solution engineer. I would also say he's a Gandhian engineer. Now, what is Gandhian engineer? I remember in 2008, I had coined this word in Australia, in Canberra, when I gave this talk on Gandhian engineering, getting more from less for more and more people, basically. And you can see that in everything that he has done, because it's all about affordable excellence, as we basically call it. So Abhay mentioned about Kinetic Luna, Kinetic Honda. I have very sort of fond memories of this, Arun. When I came back in 1976, I remember I used to travel by bus, and Vaishali used to travel by Luna, basically. And before I bought my first car, I think it was 5 to 6 years, I got a second-hand Fiat. Luna was the main vehicle that my wife used for transport, including sort of for the children. And if you go back into that, there's a classic example of not only Atmanirbhar Bharat with Atma Vishwas, but also that of Gandhi engineering. Just think about it. The kind of specification that were drawn, cost should be less than 2,000 rupees. No foreign collaborators, no use of imported raw materials, no use of imported components, manufactured by Indian machines, manufactured in backward areas of India. So when we talk about Atmanirbhar Bharat, you can't have a better example than this. And it was Gandhian engineering because it was made for sort of people like us, low middle class people. And remember, that was a huge success. And of course, then came Kinetic Honda, which was a kind of an advanced vehicle. One more point I'd like to make. They have given me 10 minutes, so I must make use of this because this is a great opportunity to pay my personal tributes. I remember, SK Firodia, of course, was an icon. I remember coming to India in 1976, coming back. And in those 80s, he was an iconic leader, and he showed us how by doing well, you can also do good for the society. It was a great inspiration. And when he passed away in 1996, Arun created these HK Firodias Awards, and I have been associated with these awards right from day one, basically. And I remember Arun's conversation with me, how much the award money should be. And I remember I was the Director General of CSIR, and we used to give Bhatnagar Prize, which was the highest prize at that time, which was 20,000 rupees, by the way. And as you all know, I'm a 10x guy, 10 times better, 10 times lower. So I said, pick it 10x, 2 lakh at that time. And if I do a calculation by using the formula given by my guru, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, every 7 years doubling up, today it is about 10 lakh. Can you just imagine that was the highest award for a large number of years till Infosys award basically came up. And I must sort of thank Arun for getting me associated with these awards. You know, they are unique awards. In fact, manje tela kay manayacha marathit yogya shabd nahi aahe maajhyakade, but it was a lucky award. Once you got that award, you will get Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, Padma Vibhushan, even Bharat Ratna. Arun, you will remember 1996, we gave it to Dr. Kalam, he became Bharat Ratna. 1997, we gave it to Professor Siena Rao, he became Bharat Ratna. Of course, the others are in the waiting list, but so there was something special. I personally, on my personal count, I will say there are so far 52 awards that have been given, and I'm very proud that each citation has been written by me. So thank you for doing me the privilege. In fact, 1 year, I remember my mother passed away 17 November 2006. And within less than a week, we had the award ceremony. And Jan Nalikar got it at that time. So I was involved as a jury. I wrote also the citation. You also made me the chief guest. So you allowed me to do many sort of records with this particular award. So we want to actually thank you. Finally, I'd like to thank you for a number of things. First, Arun, for Pune International Center. You have been a founder trustee of PIC. You have been the chairman of our infrastructure committee. You laid the foundation. You made it what it is. So thank you for that. Secondly, I can't just talk about Arun. I have to talk about Arun and Jayashree Tai together, Arun and Jaya. You know, they were the couple of the Millennium Award winner in 2000, basically. And really, they are the couple of every year and forever, as far as I'm concerned, an iconic sort of model. And we have benefited personally, Vaishali, myself, from your affection and your wonderful family, Sulajja, Kimaya, Ajinkya, Vismaya, etc. And I'm very happy to see they are doing so well in their own life in following your footsteps. The third one is this book. This is a great gift that you have given to the society. It's a coffee table book, but it should be on the table of every household because it's a timeless inspirator. Fourth, I want to thank you again for giving me the honor of writing the preface, because I think outside the Firodiya family, I was the first one to sort of read it. And fourth and final, Arun, thank you for being what you are. And thank you for whatever you have done for our society, for our nation. Thank you.
I would like to request the chair of today's event, Mr. Ravi Pandit, to say a few words and invite Mr. Firodiya to speak about his book.
So it is indeed a pleasure to be here this morning among these two stalwarts, people who I greatly value for the qualities of their head and the qualities of their heart. Talking about the author of this book, I must say Arun has been a dear friend for many decades. We spent a lot of time together at the chamber, and he was my guide at the chamber. And then I became a president a few years after he was the president. And so our association has continued very deeply, both in the chamber, then in the PIC, and especially Janwani. So I have seen multiple facets of Arun. And it was a delight to read this book called My Life's Blessings. You know, what strikes one is the basic approach toward life, where at a point in time, you say my life has been a series of countless blessings. And I like the way in which one looks at one's life. Secondly, when you leaf through this book, you know, you see a very extraordinary combination of, again, as I said, head and heart. So the warmth comes out of every page of this book. You see the pictures, and you believe that you are a part of the family. You have been invited into the drawing room of his house, and you are a part of the family. So on one side, you see the warmth. On the other side, you see the quality. The quality of the contents, the quality of the tenor of the book, and of course, of the presentation. So there is much, and of course, it has a very fitting preface written by Dr. Marshallkar. And there is much that I want to say and I have to say about it. But what I would like to do is first invite Arun to speak about the book. And then I have quite a few questions for Arun after the book is, after his basic presentation is done. So Arun, over to you. We are really looking forward to your presentation. And then looking forward to the question answer session, which I'm sure, apart from me, others will also have some questions to ask. Over to you, Arun.
Thank you, Dr. Marshallkar and Ravi. It is very gratifying to hear such kind words, and I don't know whether I deserve all this accolade, but thank you again for that. Both of you have been my guiding lights and companions for all these years, and you are done wonderfully well in R&D field, which is my passion also. Well, about the book, it is not an autobiography, but a collection of the commemorative events that happened in my life. And I consider myself very lucky that I was born in pre-independent India. So I have been able to see what India was before independence, after independence, when it struggled through, then came out, and now looking forward to a great future. So all these facets of life one is able to see. So I consider myself very lucky to have been born in pre-independent India. Also, I was lucky to be born to parents who are, so to say, honor to our society. My father was a doyen of automobile industry. My mother was a seeker of salvation. And it's very gratifying to be born to such parents. So whatever I did was always trying to make sure that the legacy of my parents and grandparents and my family, Firodia family and Kotecha family, is continued. In the book, I started first with the legacy of my father, because I think he was the greatest influence on our lives. And he was a beloved HK. Everybody called him HK or GM Sahib, but he was a beloved person. Very hardworking and open to all ideas. And he always had the guts to attempt the unthinkable. When somebody said that, government said that you want to make Matador, it should be 90% indigenous on day one. So he said, okay, I'll do. Then he wanted to go to South Africa to see a vehicle called Trax. But India and South Africa had no relations. So he managed to get a staple visa and went to South Africa. So whatever was required to be done, he always did. So he was a person of putting his heart and effort into his work. He and his brother, N.K. Firodia, were known as Ram Lakshman. They were inseparable. N.K. was a visionary, H.K. was a doer. That was their division of work. But H.K. always gave all the information to N.K. Whenever he came back from abroad, first thing he did was to go to N.K. and give him a report. So N.K. said, why are you giving me all this report? I know you must have done everything that is required. He said, no, you are the visionary, so I must keep you informed. He used to take him on the round to the shop floor. N.K. said, why are you taking me to the round to the shop floor? I have nothing to do with shop floor. All technical things are handled by you. He said, no, you must be fully informed. So such was the love and affection between the two brothers. I cannot imagine two more loving brothers than these two. H.K. was not only an automobile expert, but he was a philanthropist also. So when Latur had earthquake, he made a hospital there. And it was, all the Latur people still remember. Dr. Kukade just wrote me a letter saying he remembers how H.K. helped them. He was a technocrat par excellence, no doubt. But he was also able to strike friendships very easily. So when he was in Piaggio for some time, he made friendship with Dr. Piaggio, the owner. And he traveled with him from Pontedera to Pisa, because Dr. Piaggio lived in Pisa. So H.K. said, why not I travel with him and strike a friendship? So they traveled together. That friendship became so good. And when Bajaj Auto was started in 1960s, Dr. Piaggio deputed all his engineers to help the company to localize all the parts. So in 1968, when the collaboration ended, Bajaj Auto Limited, of which my father was general manager, did not require any further input from Italy. They had imbibed all the technology, die casting, magnetos, gears, paint shop, everything. In 1960s, to imbibe all the foreign technology was a wonder. But H.K. did it not only due to his hard work, also due to friendship he had struck with Dr. Piaggio. So a part of his success also goes to the easy manner and the friendship that he was always able to strike. Now I come to my mother. My mother was also a great influence on my life. In fact, whenever I think of my childhood, my eyes swell up always thinking of my mother. She was born in Bid, which is a town in Nizam state. There was no light, no water, no piped water, nothing, and no education for girls. But she wanted to study. So her brother, who was a freedom fighter, he called her to Wardha at Mahilashram. So he said, you come and you girls can study here. So she wanted to go. By that time, she was 13-year-old. Her father said, look, you are 13-year-old, I want to get you married. There is no way I will send you for education. So she tried cajoling her father, but to no avail. Then she went on a fast. After 13, 14 days of fast, then her father relented, said, okay, you go. And then by that time, the Bharat had already started from Rajasthan. So he had to go to Manmad or Ratlam to request them to forgive him and go back. Then my mother did her education in Mahilashram. Within 2 years, from third standard up to which she has studied, she went to matriculation of Nagpur. Then she joined SNDT College in Pune and did her GA, that is Gruhitagama, or is equivalent to BA. So she had a very illustrious career in education, but all developed by herself. After marriage, her marriage was also a very special event, because Jamna Lal Ji Bajaj, who was the mentor of Mahilashram, he liked this girl. He wrote to my grandfather that there is a girl from your community. I suggest her name too for your son. That's how the marriage between my mother and my father got initiated. After marriage, within few months, there she had to go to the Gwalior tank where the Quit India movement was started. She helped Arun Asafali to mount the stage and unfurled the flag when all Congress leaders had been arrested. But after marriage, she also did a lot of work in social service. She said, why not I teach the people who can't read and write, how to read and write. So my father, who was by that time works manager at ST Workshop Dapodi, he announced a scheme that if you can read, you'll get one increment. If you can write, you get two increment. If you can add and subtract, you'll get three increment. So and so on. So she used to teach them in a very novel way. That is, teaching the sound of an alphabet by its shape. For example, no. When you say no, you think of null. So when you write no, then you think no, and then you say no. Like that, ch, you look at ch and you say chhatri. Ch, or you look at ch and you think of chimney and you say ch. Like that, she invented a chart of how to teach alphabet, sound of an alphabet by its shape. And believe me, people could read within 1 week. Later on, F.C. Kohli also pioneered this method for Tata, and he took it much further. She was an original thinker. Then her lasting contribution to Pune is that Firodiya Karandak, which recognizes the art and talent of college students, and Ravindra Mankadi, Subodh Bhave, and host of talented people have emerged out of that competition. Finally, she was influenced by Osho. And Osho said that she is ahead of all of us, including myself, in the path to moksha. This is the greatest compliment you can hear from Osho himself. And how a girl from a backward Nizam state would rise to such eminence is something I really wonder. Then I come to my own schooling, and I had privilege of being taught by very good teachers in school and very loving teachers. Then I went to IIT, where IIT was just being made. In fact, the hostel was under construction, and there were scorpions and serpents and all kinds of things. But we knew that history is being made in IIT because we had the privilege of having a computer, a rarity in those days, servo motors, and all kinds of things which we could handle. The greatest thing that happened to me in IIT was the coming together with students from all over India, from north, east, south, west. Till then, in Pune, I was only restricted to Pune students in Shivaji Nagar. But when I went to IIT, I could meet people from all over India. So I became a truly pan-Indian, and I developed that outlook, which I value very much. And also in IIT, I was privileged to work on a thesis, which was control system of a anti-aircraft gun, for which I had to write a new theory in SS plane. So this thesis was very much appreciated by MIT people. When I went to MIT, applied, they not only gave me admission, but gave me research assistantship and gave me a project to work on control system of a torpedo. Now, that was a defense project. And to give the defense project to a young graduate engineer was something unbelievable. And that too, not American citizen. So I was pressured by them that you please accept American citizenship. I said, no, I want to go back to India. They said, no. Will exempt you from the draft for Vietnam War. I said, it's not a question of draft or anything. It's a question of I want to retain my Indian citizenship. So they very reluctantly they said that, okay, you have to work in Lincoln Laboratory, which is next to MIT. But you can work only one day in a week because we'll cordon off the area where you will work. And I will give you false data. So they used to give me false data and allow me to work only one day in a week. And then an American guy would convert that false data into correct data, but he was a bit lazy, so he said, you do both, please. So I did that, but my thesis got prolonged. And so I said, what to do? I can't just go on waiting for months and months. So I joined Sloan School of Management. So I was studying in Sloan School of Management while being research assistant in electrical engineering department, kind of unique combination. But I completed my thesis in both. Sloan School, I worked on a thesis called technological gatekeepers. That is how to locate who is the recipient of technology from rest of the world for your organization, how to make interaction with that person more smooth so that organization develops. This was done for a company called McDonnell Douglas. They adopted it, and I'm very glad to know that McDonnell Douglas did that, approve our idea that how to identify the technological gatekeepers and how to locate them. I was also very lucky to have married a person of which I called God's gift to us. And which Mr. Marshallkar also approves. It was an interreligious marriage, but our family and her family both agreed to it wholeheartedly. My wife she took to our family as fish takes to water. She has adopted our spiritual beliefs, language, food habits, and enhanced all of it. all our relatives love her, and there is a tremendous goodwill for her in the entire community. All of it earned by her lifetime of sweetness and helpfulness. She is very well adored by her extended family. Even Jain Sadhvis, Priti Sudhaji and Madhusmitaji Maharaj are very fond of her. And we are very fortunate to have received the Couple of the Millennium Award, and 90% of the credit goes to my wife. Coming to the work, as Dr. Mashalkar mentioned, that my father put down a very stringent specification list how to develop a moped. Now, he wrote to me a letter. In those days, there was no phone calls. He wrote to me a letter, come to India. I was in America working on microprocessor. I was the first batch of people who made microprocessor for Intel. He wrote me later, come back to India, we want to make a moped. I said, what is a moped? He said, a vehicle for common man. I thought he was talking of something like Volkswagen Beetle. So I said, give me 6 months time. And I wound up everything and came back to India. And he said, no, it's a vehicle between bicycle and motorcycle. I said, I'm an electronics engineer, I'm not a mechanical engineer. He said, no, don't worry, I'm there behind you. And you learn. You go and talk to mechanics, you go and talk to users, find out what they want. So we went to mechanics. Mechanics said, the roads are so bad, the tires get punctured very often. So you please make a vehicle where you can remove the puncture without opening the wheel. The one mechanic said, petrol is adulterated. So we have to decarbonize the cylinder head often. But whatever carbon we remove falls into the cylinder itself. So please make engine upside down, so that whatever carbon we remove falls on the ground. We did not make it upside down, but we made it horizontal. Then, like that, there are many inputs given by the users, and we introduced all these inputs in our design. We were lucky that we could design it on our own, because if we had a foreign collaboration, then we could not have designed all these features into the vehicle. One mechanic said, the most biggest problem in an automobile is clutch. And if you have to approach the clutch, you have to open the engine. The engine down is a big problem. So can you take clutch out? So we thought about it and we made a dry clutch. Most of the clutches are wet clutches. We made a dry centrifugal clutch. And that was very much liked by mechanics. In fact, the mechanics found the vehicle so easy to repair that one person without eyesight, he could open it thoroughly, dismantle it, and reassemble it within 2 hours. So we appreciated his gift very much, and we invited lots of mechanics to see how easy it is to repair. So they all liked that idea very much, that even a person without eyesight can repair it, open it and again reassemble it within 2 hours, then I can do it in half an hour. So Luna made a history, and at one time in Pune city alone, there were 100,000, 1 lakh Lunas flying on the road. We made more than 5 million of them. And we made many interesting innovations in marketing. But all the same, it was a vehicle by all in its own class, all by itself. Now, enthused by the shift to electric vehicles, we are going to make an e-Luna, same Luna but in electric version. And I am quite sure people would very much welcome it, because petrol prices being what they are, people would like electric vehicles. Ravi has made hydrogen, he has gone even one step forward, hydrogen powered vehicle. But we would start with electric vehicles, which can be charged at home. Next was the Kinetic Honda, which was also a collaboration product, because Government of India had announced liberation, liberalization of the policy. Earlier policy was no foreign collaboration, now they allowed. So I had gone to Japan to see various models being made by Japanese. So we happened to land into Honda showroom. And that receptionist said, which country you are from? So we said, India. So he said, wait, I'll call a person who knows your country. So she called one Mr. Vanaka. He started talking to us in Hindi. And he said, why have you not applied to us? I said, I have come to invite you. So they came, they, you know, not one but 10 teams visited. We made a very nice collaboration. The Kinetic Honda scooter became a darling of the masses. It also had the honor of being recipient of 3 Guinness Book records. As Dr. Mashilkar has pointed out, we made a HK Firodia Memorial Foundation, and the awards to the most Indian scientists in the field of technology. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, Vijay Bhatkar, CNR Rao, Anil Kakurkar, Chidambaram, Swaminathan, M.M. Sharma, Kasturi Rangan, the list is endless. All these awardees have been honored in their life, by not only by us, but by the society. And as Dr. Mashilkar has said, we were first to recognize their golden worth, and then they got further awards. Our chief guest list is also very impressive, starting from Dr. Raja Ramanna, C. Subramanyam, Narayan Murthy, Kurian, Sam Pitroda, ex-president Dr. Venkatraman, Mukesh Ambani, etc. So these awards have been a great fulfilling thing in our life, and we have devoted many pages to these awards. I think this is my personal contribution to the society. Then I was made chairman of Research Council of CSIR-CSIO, where we made many innovative products. Head-up display, earthquake warning system, Divyanayan, 3D printer, which can duplicate your knee or shoulder joint. So when you fit it, it feels very snugly fit. Then blending of tea or wine or perfume using digital nose, digital tongue, spectroscopic instrument to check adulteration of milk, disinfecting milk by passing a high voltage pulse rather than boiling it and cooling it. Just a high voltage pulse for a few seconds. Sensors for precision farming. Sensor to give advanced warning of impending disease on farms. Robotic anesthetist. Gesture controlled wheelchair. Compensation for tremor in the hands of surgeon, and many things. So all these, I'm happy to be part of this endeavor. But the thing that I really loved was cooking machine. We said, let's make a cooking machine. And the people made a cooking machine, and we made aloo matar in that, and gave that aloo matar to minister who was visiting us. And he also liked. The cooking machine is a very good device, especially for the schools where midday meals is an issue. And the teacher has to spend time in cooking. But if she has a cooking machine, then she can spend her time in teaching rather than in cooking. We also made many attempts. One attempt, noteworthy attempt I have is a Merlin TV, which was made 30 years ago, which is a TV cum computer. In those days, we had 14-inch TVs, so it strained your eyes. So I thought that why not make a TV come computer. So when you want to watch TV, you watch TV. But when you want to sit on computer, then you use the TV remote. The remote itself was a new idea in those days. On the other side of the remote was the keyboard. Use the keyboard on that remote and use it as a computer. That computer through modem was connected to your office computer. So kind of internet. So sitting at home, you could approach office computer and work on office on the data available in the office computer. In the today's day of work from home, that's a good idea, but that was 30 years ago. It was, I think, a bit premature. So I have no regrets, but I love that Merlin. At least it is a attempt in the right direction. We made many attempts in the cultural field also. As Ravi Pandit has pointed out, Maratha Chamber and Janwani. We did we developed special vehicles for injured soldiers where and donated them. So they appointed me on Sainik Welfare Board. Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan and Murtangan Exploratory were also other good attempts on my part to give back to society whatever we could get. One noteworthy thing we did was Wadgaon Memorial. It's one of the few battles which Marathas won against British. And we said, let us celebrate that Wadgaon Memorial. So we made a memorial of Deep Mar and that memorial is worth visiting. Unfortunately, it's not on the new Bombay-Pune road, but it's on the old Bombay-Pune road. So if ever you go to old Bombay-Pune road, you should see that. It is very nice memory. I got numerous awards, which I think is not due to my personal efforts, but circumstances. Circumstances actually made me. My little bit of input was just making the circumstances help for me. But people liked a little bit of work I did, gave me awards. I wrote a few books also. The current book is actually an outcome of my being idle during lockdown period. So what to do during lockdowns, I wrote down this book. And it has come out nicely because it is picturized also very well. So that great picturization is due to efforts of my wife and Ravindra Mankani and his assistant. I've written about my children who are exceptionally extraordinary children. I'm sure they'll carry on our legacy further. Then I've written about our super families, Firodia family, my uncle N.K. Firodia, not to mention the Kotecha family, of which 7 people went to jail and 4 of them got Freedom Fighter Award. 7 people in one family and 4 of which were women. The names of my cousin were Subhash, Jawahar, Sarojini, Vijaya, Kamala. So you can imagine the atmosphere in the family. Kotecha family wanted to be another Nehru family. So this atmosphere was very well appreciated by even Gandhiji, who wrote us letters. And the Kotecha family is one which has given me that additional input for love for India. My India of my dream is what Dr. Mashilkar wanted me to speak on, so I'll take a few minutes. First thing I said is India should have power to face disasters. Pandemics, in which Kerala has shown us the way. Cyclones, in which Odisha and Andhra have shown us the way. Floods, again Andhra, by linking the Godavari and Krishna together. Earthquakes, we have not been able to solve the earthquake issue, nobody can, but at least you can learn from Japan how to make earthquake-proof houses. Carbon neutrality, Sikkim and northeastern states are carbon neutral. How to learn from them? Green energy. Rajasthan has taken great strides to generate solar energy. Arunachal, hydroelectric power. Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra, wind energy. Energy from sea waves. Gujarat can tap energy from tides. Uttar Pradesh can produce biogas. In short, India can be and should be self-sufficient in green energy. Ravi Pandit has made great advance in conceptualizing hydrogen energy from biomass. I think it's a great effort. And I wish him all the success. Because late APJ Abdul Kalam had dream of providing urban amenities to rural area. So if you can provide them hydrogen from biomass, which can be converted to electricity, and if you can generate nitrogen from electrolysis, then it will improve the livability of villages and prevent migration to cities. So it will help in decongesting the cities also. So pollution-free life we should have. Uttar Pradesh has embarked on the Namami Gange project. And I think every, including Mula Mutha River, we need to copy the Namami Gange project. Second is power to face external threat. Where a strong economy is required. A strong economy can be obtained by treating our industrialists as economic warriors. We are always treating our economists as people who are only profit-minded, but no, they are doing good job for our country. So we should value their contribution and modify our policies to help them promote our industry. Similarly, export, tourism, education are the areas which are required to be promoted. Most important is farm power, organic farming, water abundance. These are the areas in which India should put. Emphasize. And there is a debate whether we should pursue GDP or human development. I'm glad to say that Kerala is up there in human development index. If all of us follow Kerala example, we all can be up there. We need not be 129th in human development index. So each state of our country has shown the way forward. If they have shown the way forward, then we can learn from each other and hope for the better future. So these are some of the thoughts in my book. I hope you like them. And I give thanks to Dr. Mashilkar and Ravi Pandit for giving me the opportunity to present the book. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Arun, for taking us through this really truly delightful and very engaging and very educated book. So let me begin by a few questions. So Arun, a big facet of your personality is love for technology. Love for technology actually at two complete ends of technology. On one side, there is a tremendous depth of knowledge. At the other end, there is this habit of doing tinkering so that you can do something and it's an extraordinary mix of both these things coming together. And I see technology in the work that you do, this slew of innovations that you talked about. I see technology loves in the HK Firodia Awards. And, you know, I keep on getting from you every now and then some new snippets about what is the latest thing that is happening in technology. How do you manage to keep up to date on technology? What is it that that drives you in that? Can you tell our audience about that?
Look, India can progress by imbibing the latest technology only. And technology alone can take India forward. So all of us have to keep abreast of technology. That is for sure. And having gone to IIT and MIT, which gave me good insight into technology, I think I can imbibe any new technology very easily. In IIT, we learned physics, chemistry, maths for 3 years. And engineering only for 1 or 2 years.
Yes.
So I could change from electrical engineering to mechanical engineering very easily. In fact, if I was told now you change to chemical engineering, I think within 6 months I could have changed to chemical engineering.
I wish you had.
So all that is thanks to the wonderful background of IIT.
Yes.
You
yes.
learn physics, chemistry, maths.
Yeah.
So learning technology is kind of a passion.
Yes.
But
yes.
tinkering with hand.
Yes.
Is also one of my favorite things because being yes. electrical engineering, I was pushed into mechanical engineering.
Yes.
I could do everything on my own from a shoestring budget.
Yes. Yes.
So while doing that, I learned things on the way.
Yes.
I was never a manager, so to say. I was always an engineer.
Yes, yes.
By choice, I was an engineer. By circumstances, I became manager.
That is very, 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 very well put, Arun. Arun, I have one other question to ask you. Now, you see, you have, of course, spoken very lovingly about Jayashrita in the book. I remember an incident when both of us, along with a few of our friends, were at a social gathering in the evening. And so there were like 5 people and 4 chairs. And Jayashrita was there, and you hurriedly went out and got a chair from her, for her. And all of us tremendously appreciated the chivalry and all said, look how Arun does work for his wife. And Jayashrita's comment was that we have a very simple division of labor. When we are outside the house, Arun does work for me. When we are inside the house, I do all the work for Arun. So tell me, how do you manage such a witty and intelligent person in your day-to-day life, especially if that person is on a mission to improve you all the time? I'm asking this question because I have a similar problem at my home. So tell me what you feel about it.
See, I have great respect for women to begin with.
Yes.
And the work they do.
Yes. And
I was the only child to my mother.
Yes.
So I used to help her in everything. So
yes.
I can do cooking. Only thing I cannot do is to make it totally round chapati. Other than that, I can do everything. So that respect for women is what
yes.
I think is carried on in a little part of my life.
Yes, yes. Now, all of us who know you so well have tremendous love, affection and respect for Jayashrita. I must say that, you know. And your affection and respect for her has come through so eloquently in the book. And you just now said, that the pictorial presentation, etc., she was deeply engaged in that. And, you know, you can see her presence in this making of this book very, very clearly. I could notice that as soon as I opened the book and I said, you know, there is her hand in it too.
Exactly.
Talking about women, there is one question, Arun, I want to ask you. You see, you and me have had extraordinarily similar career. I'm 7-8 years younger too, but to you. But you know, like both of us went to Bhavi school. Huh? Then both of us went to modern high school. Then we both went to Deccan Education Society colleges, which was, you know, you went to Ferguson, I went to BMCC. And we both ended in MIT and came back right after MIT. So there have been all these common things. There is one thing which is very uncommon and which is very unusual. You went to the school to which my wife went, and that was an all-girl school. You were probably the only man in that all-girl school. How did you end up there?
A good question.
What happened was, my father came back from USA.
Yes.
And he saw me playing around.
Yes.
So he said, what, you're 6-year-old and just playing around? Go to school from tomorrow. My two cousin sisters, Shamajiji and Kamajiji,
yeah,
used to go to a school called St. Columba High School.
Yes.
Girgaon.
Yes.
So he said, you go with them. So I went with them. Then they got me admitted into the second standard.
Uh-huh.
But it was an all-girls school.
Yeah.
So my teacher put me in charge, under charge of one Kaumudi Pradhan, who took care of me and brought helped me. Yes, you're right. I was the only boy in the class.
So Arun, you have written about Luna, and in this book, and I must say, both me and my wife were proud owners of Luna at one time in our lives. I don't know. I can't think of any Punekar who didn't own a Luna and who did not. Actually, my experience on automotive was actually began with Luna. So all of us have really loved and grown with Luna. So you have talked about Luna as a technology. You have talked about Luna as a marketing exercise. I want to, we all of us would like to hear from you about Luna as a leadership experience for you. You know, your father told you to do these things and he actually left everything to you. How did you learn leadership through that? And tell us about the leadership experience, because I'm sure this extraordinary concept was given to you and you worked with your team to make it happen. So how did you learn? How was the leadership built through that?
We learned on the way. There was no guide, so to say. Learned on the way. And great credit goes to my father. Every day I used to go to him and ask for some help.
Yes.
And he used to provide us that help. So I said to him, 30 lakhs is not enough to make dice. So he said, come with me to telco. So he took me to Dr. Mrugavkar. And he said, see, my son wants to make a vehicle. Please make dice for him. So he said, we don't make dice for others, but since you have come all the way, I'll make for you. So telco made dice for us. Similarly, Dr. Patil of HMT, my father told him that, look, my son wants to make a moped. He wants 5 SPMs. So can you make 5 SPMs for him? So he said, yes, why not? So my father said, but charge him less. You can charge me more in Bajaj Tempo if you want, but you charge him less.
Yes.
Then my father helped me all the way from beginning till end.
Yeah. So I'm sure the audience has many questions, but I have one last question to ask. And I think we are also beyond 12, so we might want to finish in another few minutes. You see, I also had the privilege of working very closely with HK Sahib, you know, especially because of this, the whole chamber work at one point in time. So he obviously had the pride of having a very deserving son, you know, and a deserving son of a very accomplished father. Give us some instances which expressed his pride and affection in you.
He never showed any. In fact, he did not know in which class I was. So he left everything to me. But he was there whenever I needed him.
Yes, yes.
Other than that, we had no.
So yes.
It was always a one-way street.
But that one-way street has been very, very beneficial for you, right?
Yes. So,
are you giving a similar one-way street to your children, or you are not giving them a one-way street?
No, I am available.
Yeah. I would like to hear Sulajja say that. That's another matter. So, yeah. So thank you. Thank you very much, Arun. Abhay, do we have questions from the audience?
Yes, this has been a very memorable discussion. And one question that we have from Mr. Deepak Shekharpur is, sir, what are your views on globalization in the new normal? And many governments, including USA, UK, are welcoming Indian talent as in the last century. What would you like to say about this?
Globalization is essential for India's progress. See, when there was a rail link from Pune to Bombay, Pune people could go to Bombay and could see that there is an Elphinstone College, St. Xavier's College, there is textile mill. So they said, why not start a Ferguson College here? Why not start Rajabadhan, Motilal, Pune mills here? If there was no railway link, but if Pune people had to go to Bombay by bullock cart, then Pune would not have progressed. Similarly, globalization is a link for India to the world. And India will greatly progress if we travel. When I was in the CSIR society budget making, the finance minister's person always used to cut down on travel. He said, I will increase the value of the equipment you want to buy, but cut down on travel. I said, no, please reduce the value of equipment, but allow people to travel. By traveling only, they can see the world, they can interact, they can learn so many things. Equipment we can defer by 1 year, or we can borrow from other institute, but please allow people to travel. So traveling and globalization is a must. That is the only way to progress.
Thank you. Thank you.
Question from Mr. M.V. Ramanna, who worked for many years in the Ferrodia Group. What would be your three guiding principles for young engineers today?
One is look ahead. What has happened in the past need not constrain your absorption of knowledge for looking ahead. One should always think what will happen in future and train yourself for that. Secondly, do it yourself. Doesn't matter that you are not going to do it every day, but you have to do it once at least. For example, first Luna was built by myself and Dr. Panduranga, our R&D manager, ourselves. First Kinetic Honda was built by myself and Mr. Kajiura of Japan, ourselves, at night. But we said we will do it ourselves once. So you're that having done it once gives you that confidence of tackling any problem. So be a hands-on manager. That is my second thing. And third is you are as good as your colleagues. You have to learn from your colleagues, from your subordinates, from your workers, from your boss, from everybody. So you're only as good as the number of people you learn from. These are my three little snippets.
Thank you.
Sir, I would like to ask Dr. Vijay Kelkar if you would like to make any comments.
No, Abhay, I think it was so enriching presentation about him and his life and what he has done. I'm really, really feel myself lucky to be sort of to know him so many, many years and also learn from him. So I just want to wish him continued active life and continued happiness.
Thank you very much, Arun. Thank you.
By the way, Vijay is also modern as well.
Now Dr. Marshallkar is going to feel very lonely.
So. I would like to move to the vote of thanks for this program. We are We have exceeded by some minutes, but it's all in order. Thank you very much, Mr. Firodia, for sharing the extraordinary story of your life. There is a deep sense of gratitude in the title of your book itself. And we see this sense of gratitude throughout your book. You spoke of the enormous influence of your parents on your life, the many challenges that you addressed successfully as an engineer, and the social contributions that you made through a Gandhian approach. And of course, you spoke of your vision for India. Thank you very much, Dr. Mashelkar, for sharing your very warm memories and speaking about your long association with the Firodia family. Thank you, Mr. Pandit, for chairing this session and for asking some very interesting questions which enriched this discussion. Finally, I wish to thank our viewers for their participation in this program, and my colleagues Kiran and Amresh for their back-end support. As Dr. Mashelkar said, the new year is just 8 days away. And before closing, I would like to wish everyone a very happy new year. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.